welcome to Lake Rayburn United Methodist Church, and I pray that God blesses you in some very special way today with what takes place here. I would remind you that immediately following service, there is a soup and cornbread meal to be served, and they've got it decorated beautifully like a Mardi Gras. Yes, and the Bling Sisters are blinging, and all is right in the world. So, hey, we got one more question to make things right. Muddy, are you the one that makes the cornbread and jalapenos?
You talking to me?
Are you the one that
makes it? Mary Jo.
Huh?
Mary Jo.
Mary Jo. Yeah. Mary Jo. You make it?
Yeah.
All right. We're good. We're good. Everything is good. That is good stuff. Okay. If you look at our announcements today, you see that Saturday at 11 o'clock, we will have the memorial service for Jan Wade. We invite you all to come and pay tribute to her. Jim is really having a difficult time. So please be in prayer for him and talk with him. March 3rd at 10 o'clock, we'll have an outreach meeting. And so everybody has anything to do with reaching out to anybody outside this church. So, and we want you all to be there because it's going to be kind of a planning, a brainstorming, a planning type of thing to figure out how we're going to reach out to the community here. So please be there. And don't forget that the 13th of March is daylight savings time. So now there is no excuse to say I forgot to change my clock, so I missed it. Is there any other announcements before we go on? And I just remind you that we do still need people to sign up for coffee hour and people to sign up for sound and video and for serving communion and for readers of the Holy Word. So there are lists on the back in the fellowship hall. We can go back there to eat, sign up. Anything else? No birthdays, no anniversaries? Yes, ma'am.
Richard's only aunt at the end of this month is going to be 100.
Oh, wow. What a blessing. Where's she at?
She's got stents in her heart, and she's got dry macular. She's going blind.
Where's she at?
Vernon, Texas. Vernon?
Texas. Vernon? Okay. Well, God bless her. We'll keep her in our prayers, too.
She's a full-blood German. And Richard, we went for her 85th or something. I can't remember what it was. And he was out talking to his cousin, and she comes in and says, Aunt Ruth, I've come for this, and I'm supposed to be in here talking to you. She said, yeah, you are.
She hadn't lost her. That's why she's 100. She lived this long. She hadn't lost her spit and her fire about
her. She's a full-blood German.
That's it. That's that part of it, too. Okay. Do we have any others? Anybody else? Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty and loving Father, in signs and wonders, your Son revealed the greatness of your saving love. We ask that you would renew your people with your grace and that you would sustain us by your power. For we know that we can do nothing without you. And we ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Would you stand, please, and let's sing. Take number 311. Number 311.
Thank you.
Don't look behind you. Did you sing?
I listened.
It was the first time for most of us, so that's okay. We'll get it. Okay, if you turn your hymnal to page 772 and join me with our responsive reading, Psalm 37, verses 1 through 11. Do not be angry because of the wicked. Do not be envious of wrongdoers.
For they will soon fade like the grass and wither like the green herb.
Trust in the Lord and do good, so you will dwell in the land and enjoy security.
Take delight in the Lord, who will give you the desires of your heart.
Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in God, who will act, bringing forth your vindication as the light and your right as the noonday.
Be still and wait patiently before the Lord. Do not be angry because of those who prosper in their way, because of those who carry out evil devices.
Refrain from anger and forsake wrath. Do not be angry. It leads only to evil.
For the wicked shall be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord shall possess the land.
Yet a little while, and the wicked will be no more. Though you look at their place, they will not be there.
The wicked shall possess the land and delight in abundant prosperity.
You know, that really grabs me, that verse that says, do not be angry, it leads only to evil. That's so true, so true. Would you please stand now and join me in the Apostles' Creed as printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Song and every silence, singing word and melody.
Now, as we prepare to go to the Lord in prayer, you see our list. We have many, many on the list that's on the insert in our bulletin. But we may have missed someone. Is there someone that we have missed or that we need to add on to here or some event? Okay. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most loving Father, we come to you today with difficulties in our minds and in our hearts. We fear that war is raising its ugly head again. The Russians are firing missiles into the Ukraine. And we know that's just a pretext to assault. We ask that you would enter into the hearts and minds of all of the leaders of the world, especially the leaders involved here, and remind them that they are not the powerful ones, it is you. And remind them of where their life comes from and where it can go. Fill their hearts with love for all of creation. Stem this tide of war that we feel is coming. Make me a fool just for even bringing it up because you've already got things in place to handle it. And Lord, we have service members over there. We pray for all of them, all of our service members, all of our police officers, all of our firemen, all of our EMTs, and anyone else who helps us in service at the times when we run away. Without you in their heart, they couldn't do their jobs. They wouldn't. Then I pray for this church. As we begin to gain strength again after the COVID episode for a year and a half, 2 years, we're gaining strength again, and we know that's only because of you. And we thank you for that. We ask you to be with us in our meetings and the things as we try to figure out ways to reach out to the public, to let them know that not only do you love them, but so do we. And that they have a seat here in this church anytime and every time we meet. Make us that beacon that you designed us to be in this community for your love. And Lord, you see all those on our prayer list. A lot of difficulties, a lot of heartbreak. People are mourning. People are hurting, people are in pain, people are just sick. Put your mighty hand upon each and every one of them. Let it rest there until they are healed in whatever way you design. For it's your will, Lord, not ours. And now, Father, we ask that you would help us to pray the prayer that Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord, your healer. I sing my words and heal your disease. I am the Lord, your healer. You are the God that healeth thee. You are the
now where our ushers come forward, that we can return a portion of God's love back to him. Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
This next song we're going to sing, Marilyn's going to kill me, but she doesn't like for me to say anything about the songs, but this one. The next song is Why Me, Lord? And this song was actually written and performed by Kris Kristofferson. And there was a story that went along with it. He had been playing a concert with the Gatlin brothers. And the next morning, he went to church with them. And you have to imagine, Kris Kristofferson wasn't a real religious person. But he was so moved by the sermon that he left and he wrote this song. And so that's how this song came about. Because like I said, Kris Kristofferson isn't known for his religion necessarily. And also, when we decided to sing this song, Maggie asked me, she said, well, what key do you want to sing it in? And I said, well, I just want to sing it just like Kris Kristofferson. She said, what key is that? I said, off key. So so anyway, our guitars aren't amped up, so you won't be able to hear them very well, but hopefully you can hear us sing. Why me, Lord? What did I ever do that was worth loving you for the pleasures I've known?
Tell me, Lord, what have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known?
Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. But now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Try me, Lord. If you think there's a way I can try to repay all I've taken from you.
Maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you.
Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. But now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. But now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands.
Jesus,
my soul's in your hands.
Please join me in the contemplation of God's Word. Today's scripture is found in the New Testament book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 42 through 50. For God has put all things in subjection under his feet. But when it says all things are put in subjection, it is plain that this does not include the one who put all things in subjection under him. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to the one who will put all things in subjection under him, so that God may be all in all. Otherwise, what will those people do who receive baptism on behalf of the dead? If the dead are not raised at all, why are people baptized on their behalf? And why are we putting ourselves in danger every hour? I die every day. That is as certain, brothers and sisters, as my boasting of you, a boast that I make in Christ Jesus our Lord. If with merely human hopes I fought with wild animals of Ephesus, what would I have gained by it? If the dead are not raised, let us eat, drink, for tomorrow we die. Do not be deceived. Bad company ruins good morals. Come to a sober and right mind and sin no more. For some people have no knowledge of God. I say this to your shame. But someone who will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? Fool, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. As for what you sow, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed, its own body. Today's gospel is found in the New Testament book of Luke, chapter 6, verses 27 through 38. But I say to you that listen, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you. And if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you hope to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to receive as much again. But love your enemies, do good, and lend, expecting nothing in return. Your reward will be great, and you will be the children of the Most High. For he is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap. For the measure you give will be the measure you get back. The word of the Lord for the people of God.
I want to thank Maggie and John. I thought y'all were going to do some Lynyrd Skynyrd, but it's okay. I like that one too. Great song. I love that song. It's a great song. We should all be able to sing that song. And I will tell you, I doubt any of you are going to be inspired to write music after the sermon today. But if you are, I get the rights to it. Okay. I want to ask you. And this is going to be a real dumb question because of all the age of all of us. But how many of you were raised on a farm? Know anything about that? Been raised on a farm? Yeah. How about those of you that had parents or grandparents that had a farm that you got to go to and visit all the time? Yeah, most of us. Most of us know those things. I wasn't raised on a farm, but my grandparents had a farm. And I loved going on summer vacation to the farm where my grandparents were. Those are some of my favorite memories, of going to visit my grandparents and going out into the garden with my grandfather, and he just seemed to know everything about everything. He just seemed to know when something was ripe and it was ready to pick. He'd go out there and he would smell of the fruits and vegetables and say, well, that's ready or that's not ready. And he'd feel of some of them and say they're ripe or not, and then the melons, he'd thump the melons. And he tried to teach me that. I never could learn that. He'd thump the melon and see if they were ripe and they were ready to pick. Now, I don't know if all that stuff was just show for me, trying to put on a show for his grandson or not, but I suspect it was real. But he always amazed me out there on the farm. He knew when to plant, when to harvest. He even knew when it was going to rain. How many of you had grandparents that told you, if the cows are laying down in the field, it's going to rain? You ever heard that?
Yes.
Yeah. Everybody, we drive by fields now, and most of the cows are laying down. There's a few of them standing up. We say, those are the ones that didn't get the word. But he could do that. And think about, like Alice said the other day, we were talking about this, about vegetables and fruits that you would can. She says, yeah, you eat all you can, then you can all you can't. You got that? And you put fruits and vegetables. How many people know how to do that still today? How many people will do it still today? I see a few hands out there. My wife came to me one time, said, when I was in the military, a friend of mine had a farm. She says, I'd like to have some tomatoes to put up. I brought her 3 60-pound boxes of tomatoes. She put up tomatoes till they were coming out of her ears. We had tomatoes for a long time. She never asked me for anything else. I don't know why. But they knew how to do those things. And somehow, we've lost most of these things. They're not important to us today. You know, we live in cities, and we can go to grocery stores, and, you know, if you want a tomato, you can go pick up a can. It's got a tomato in it. You want some green beans? Pick up a can. It's got green beans. We don't do those things. And we seldom go to farms. And I think that's really a sad thing. I think it's a terrible thing. I think we're losing something in our communities, our civilization is really going to come back someday and bite us. Now, the Israelites. The reason I say all that, because the Israelites lived a farming type of life. And they knew all these things too. So it's not surprising that Paul's talking to people that knows all about farming and harvesting and reaping and that he would talk to them in terms that they could understand. Terms about being on a farm. He speaks about the general resurrection, when Christ returns. This is when our mortal, sinful bodies will be raised in glory as an immortal and cleansed body of all sin. All traces of dishonor will vanish. And though we see glimpses of glory today in our world, we live in a world that is corrupt. And as such, our bodies are sown in dishonor and degradation and decay and corruption. These are wonderful bodies that God gave us to live in and to enjoy, and we have destroyed them through our sinful nature. Paul uses that term sown, meaning buried, like you bury a seed to plant it, meaning buried, to indicate the forgiveness of our sins as Christ died and was buried for us. But the great and wonderful news is that he arose again. Christ arose and he promised us the very same thing. We too will be raised in glory when he returns. All we have to do is keep following him. Keep doing the things he wants us to do. Like the old farmers who remembered how nature works and what's needed to grow good and full crops, we have to remember what God's word is and what's expected of each one of us. Then in Luke's gospel, we find out how to sow good crops and come up with the best crops. You know, a lot of times people tell us to do something and they don't tell us how you do it, how you go about it. Well, Luke's going to tell us. First of all, he says something that Jesus said, and oh, it caused so much trouble, so much problem in the world. It's unbelievable. He said, love your enemies. Do good to those who hurt you. Bless those who curse you, and pray for those who abuse you. Oh, my goodness. You see, before Jesus came on the scene, it was considered a right and a good thing to hate our enemies. After all, they must have done something wrong. There must have been something bad, that some good reason that we have enemies. So it's a good reason that we should hate them. That's the old thing you see about the people in the South having feuds, and they say, well, what are you feuding about? So, I don't remember. But we just don't like those people. And it must have been a tough thing for them to change, to love their enemies. How difficult is that? They had probably hated these people for years and years, maybe generations. You think maybe that'd be as tough as for us today to hate our enemies, to change that into love? You know, I was raised to think that we're not supposed to have any enemies. I was raised to believe that we're not supposed to hate anybody. And you know, maybe if we decided that we'd love our enemies instead of hate them, maybe they wouldn't be enemies anymore. If we did love our enemies and they loved us, all these other things that come in the scripture wouldn't be an issue. It just wouldn't mean anything, because in love we couldn't do those things. I would tell you a story about I just finished a book about an old church father. You know I love the old church fathers. And his name was John the Little. And he was called John the Little because he was a dwarf. Physically, he was a very small man, but spiritually, he was a giant. And one day, some of the priests in the church where he served got together, and they decided, we're just going to see if this man is who everybody thinks he is. He doesn't claim to be anything special, but the other people say he is. We're going to just check it out and see if he really is that. And John walked into the church one day, and one of the old priests walked up and just slapped him in the face. And he says, you're no longer welcome here. And he ran him out of the church. He didn't say a word, and he left the church. Later, a few days later, they went to check on John, some of the priests, and they said, we want to see how John handled this test. Did he pass this test, or did he fail? Is he over there fuming, mad, plotting revenge? And they asked him, said, John, what did you think about what happened in the church the other day? And John asked him, what are you talking about? What happened in the church? See, John didn't get angry. John didn't hold a grudge. He had let it pass so easily that he couldn't even remember what had happened. Needless to say, the priests were all amazed at John's humility before God. And I think about that, and I say, man, I don't know. I'm going to pick on Gary because I'm looking at him. I said, Gary, you walk into church here and some man walks up to you and slaps you in the face and says, you're not welcome anymore. Get out. Am I going to have to break up a fight or a shooting? Or both? But something's going to happen. We're, as men in our society, we're taught we don't take that. Nobody hits us. And let alone slap us. If you punch a man, that's a whole different thing than slapping a man. You slap a man, one man slaps another man, that's saying you're not even a man. You're not worth punching. I wish I could tell you I had the same humility that John the Little had. I wish I could tell you I had the same grace about me that John the Little has. But I'd be lying if I told you that. I don't have that kind of grace. But loving our enemies is of uppermost importance. You can see what Christ is trying to do. You know, see, it's loving our friends and our family. So what? Everybody loves their friends and their family. Even sinners love their families and their friends and their children. But if we love even our enemies, we'll receive a reward in heaven. Oh, and we will be called the children of the God Most High. Then Luke reminds us of something we don't like to think about. We don't want to hear this because of who we are. It says, God loves even the ungrateful and the wicked. We're like, no, God couldn't do that. How could he love some of these people? How could he love, say, Hitler? Oh my gosh, murdered millions of people. How could God still love him? Because he's God, and he does still love him. You think of some of the people in your life that have wronged you and hurt you, and you can say, what a horrible person. How could they live that kind of life? God still loves them and takes care of them. And he calls us to love them. And he calls us to be merciful like he is. And he calls us not to judge. My friends, that's what I call a full plate. to love our enemies. Just that. That is a full plate because it's very difficult to do in our world. And we can't hope to do that on our own. Only in Christ can we move forward. Only in Christ may we be raised in glory. And that's what we're all seeking here, to be raised in glory. So love your enemies. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. Father, you have loved us. You have blessed us. You have stood beside us through all the thick and thin. Help us to be grateful. Help us to be loving. And help us to love our enemies and turn them into friends. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand, please, and turn in your hymnals to page number 557, number 557.
Take that love to everyone, even those who hurt you. Amen. Surely.